Hey y'all, so welcome to another video. And in this video, I want to discuss how patriarchy and religion is a death cult, like religion in and of itself, like all religion, especially the patriarchal religions, especially the Abrahamic religions. For those who don't know, those are the religions as following Christianity, Islam, Judaism. Their main branch of connectivity is Abraham. They all feature Abraham. They rewrite Jesus a little bit differently. They got an Old Testament. They got a New Testament. Like they have similar features, and it stems from Abraham, right? But even with Abraham, didn't he have to like sacrifice a kid or some shit like that? Like, it's either Moses or some kid, or maybe it was Abraham himself, where it was like to test his allegiance to God. He had to sacrifice a kid. And at the last moment, God came down from the heavens. It was like, yo, chill. Like, you don't got to sacrifice a kid. I was just trying to test your loyalty. Like, again, religion and just patriarchy in and of itself is a death cult. And when you start peeling back the layers of how much death is featured and embedded in our culture, you'll start to get it. For example, oil in a very generalized, lacking of nuance and science, but basically is liquefied human body parts, because oil has been in the ground for centuries. It takes time for it to liquefy and become of that gooey consistency and have all the protons, electrons, and all this other shit that makes oil what it is. Oil is decaying matter. So like dead humans, dead dinosaurs, dead animals, over time they liquefy and they become oil.
Crude oil and natural gas, where exactly do they come from? Well, their formation occurred in a process that took millions of years and are the remains of plants, animals, and microorganisms that once lived long ago, way before the dinosaurs. Today, they are known as fossil fuels, based roughly on the Latin word fossilis, meaning dug up. Crude oil and natural gas were created from biotic materials, which are basically the remains of tiny marine plants and animals that once lived millions and millions of years ago in an aquatic environment. Through the years, these plants and animals died and were buried by layers of sediment, sand, and water. Microorganisms fed on the decomposing organic material in a process called biogenesis. More layers of sediment eventually build up and bury their remains deeper and deeper within the earth. The enormous pressure from these layers combined with the heat from beneath the earth's crust essentially cooked the biotic materials within certain rock layers to form the crude oil and natural gas deposits we have today.
Did you know the U.S. military is the largest oil user in the world? Unfortunately, moving fuel on the battlefield is dangerous, and the oil is expensive. A $10 increase in the price of a barrel of oil costs the military more than $1 billion. Money we can't use to protect, train, and equip our troops.
So what can we do? So-called new sources of oil are still dirty, risky, and expensive. The real solution is to use less oil.
And don't we run on oil? Ain't that why we fight in Russia right now? Isn't that why we was in Iraq? Like, doesn't this whole existence runs on oil? The fact that we're dealing with climate change has to do with the fact of how much we consume and we drill for oil. Hell, our U.S. currency is backed up with oil, like the petrodollar. Death cult. Same thing, could take it to the military. No one looks at the military, whether it's the United States military or some other foreign country's military, and says, oh, thank God, what we really needed was more war, chaos, murder, and rapes. Like, oh, thank God the military's here. Like, whoo, that's what we really needed in society today. Like, that's what the military is there for. They are the henchmen. They are kind of like the muscle, not even kind of like, they are the muscle of the government, but not only the government, the corporations, because let's be clear, whatever corporation says we're about to infiltrate whatever motherfucking country and overthrow and back up evil coups, we feeling to do that because at the end of the day, it's down to the almighty dollar. So I don't have to really go on and really dissect the military, but we're pretty clear that the military is not friendly. Like, they literally got a gun to the hip. They're really shooting from the clouds with the drones. Like, that in and of itself is a death cult, right?
Power in Libya in 1969, long time ago. Do you have thoughts on who might succeed you?
I gave up power or authority since 1977. Once this Jamahiriya was established, the state of the masses was established, the people's authority was also established. Ever since that date, I am not in power anymore.
So you are not the leader of your country?
I am the leader of the revolution, not the leader of the country.
There's still a revolution going on.
Yes.
What's your proudest achievement?
The establishment or the emergence of the people's authority. And laying down the cornerstone for the world, a new era. It's the era of the masses.
What was your biggest mistake? No one's perfect.
For sure, mistakes.
Do you have a mistake that you wish you could do over?
I confess that a number of mistakes happened. One of the mistakes that I may mention, that ever since the inception of the revolution, we were very much enthusiastic and eager to have the nuclear weapon, to manufacture a nuclear bomb. After we have grown up and we have seen how the world changed, we have seen that it is not beneficial.
You want to see all nuclear weapons gone?
تريد أن ترى كل أسلحة النووية منتهية نهاية لكل أسلحة النووية.
Wow. Unconfirmed. Yeah. Unconfirmed. No. Unconfirmed reports about Gaddafi being captured. Unconfirmed. Yeah, we've had too many. We've had a bunch of those before. We've had, you know, have had him captured a couple of times.
So, I mean, that is the land of unconfirmed.
Yes, we came, we saw, he died.
Did it have anything to do with your visit?
No, I'm sure it did.
We can even look at it from the point of patriarchy. Patriarchy's view of women is very much, you are the breeders of society. You are here to be the bottom bitch. And that's how women are treated. Even the term bottom bitch, the term bitch is always associated with women. It's not until recently we started using the term bitch and associating it with men. But even when we use it to men, no one's like, oh, that's my bitch. Look at my bitch with a fresh beard in the lineup. That's my bitch. No. When men are called bitches, it's a way to sneak diss and snub their manhood. It's a way to question their authority, to question their personhood. Not only calling a man a bitch is a way to insult him, but it's also a way of subtly telling him that he needs to align with the archaic and confinement of what it means to be a man. You're slipping on your watch. You're not being a man. Like, you're making us other men, us real men, look bad because you're not acting in accordance to what we define manhood to be. And therefore, you're not a man. You're a bitch. You're less than a man. You're a lesser woman. You're a bitch. Not even a woman, but a lesser version of a woman. These motherfuckers know that they can't call their mamas a bitch, but they'll call a woman they don't know a bitch, right? So there's respectability politics, there's hierarchy politics when men casually throw out the word bitch.
This is Al Pennyfeather, and I'm here in the heart of Times Square, New York City, and there is just bitch-assness rampant everywhere I look, up, down, and all around. I just seen about a dozen people walk by me that had just so much bitch-assness in them, it was ridiculous. This is a cold orange alert. I repeat,
I thought it was quarantined.
Let's go back to Sheila in the studio.
There are several signs of bitch-assness. Short-term memory loss, excessive excuses, chronic blinking, scratching. Please use precaution before coming into contact with anyone, for they may be a carrier of the disease.
Who is it?
It's David. I'm here to go over your schedule for the day.
Schedule?
How do I know you haven't been infected with the bitch-assness disease? You were supposed to be here an hour ago.
I know, sir, but I got stuck in traffic trying to get here from the studio.
Excuses. First sign of bitch-assness. Did you bring my iPod with you for my run this morning?
I think I forgot it, sir. Let me go get it right now.
David has been infected with the bitch-assness disease.
David, you have been infected. Move away from my door right now.
No, sir. I'm clean. There's no bitch-assness here, bad boy.
Hello. Yes, I need you to get over here right away. We have a case of bitch-assness up at the penthouse, floor 100. Yes, get over here right away, please.
All right, stay right there. I'll be out in a second.
That was close, y'all. Bitch assness is back. Please do yourself a favor. Go to.
On top of that, when a man is romantically involved in a healthy and reciprocal, emotionally available, emotionally intelligent relationship with a woman, and he is acting in partnership and not domineering, what do men say? Ah, here we go. Oh, he pussy with, he like a bitch. Oh, so she wears the pants, you wear the panties. Oh, you gotta check in with your old woman. Oh. Again, you're not acting in accordance to these bum-ass niggas' standards of what it means to be a real man. And therefore, they have to gang up on you so you could revert back to their shitty status. Because birds of a feather. But not only that, if they can't have what you got, then they want you to jeopardize and sacrifice your healthy relationship so you can be tired, useless, community dick like they are. So you can have the baby mama drama that they do. So you can have the unavailable relationships that they have. So you actually rising up to the occasion and setting a new standard as a man is threatening to their low tier status, because if you stand up and set the tone, then that means they, who are in opposition to the way that you're acting, have to either rise to the occasion or pull you down. And because most men, regardless if they are mama boys, no matter if they got sisters, doesn't matter if they are married, they have daughters, they value the opinions and the camaraderie with other men, then they will ever, mark my words, ever. Men will not tell you what the fuck I'm telling you now. Ever appreciate, value, and desire their approval from women, even their own mamas, even their own sisters, even their own daughters, right?
Like, can we tell the truth and shame the devil? Men spend too much of their time trying to prove their heterosexuality, trying to prove that they live up to the standard of what it means to be a real man. Like, men can't even give other men compliments without saying, no homo, 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 no. Like, there are grown ass men with kids in these streets who cannot have a healthy platonic relationship with other men because they fear someone's going to deem that as gay or deem that as sexually fluid or suspect. This is why Benzino is breaking his non-existent neck to let y'all know he did not fuck that trans woman. And even if he did, that is his right to do so. But he even said himself, he has never been associated with LGBTQ. He has been a bigot in the past. But this time around, even with the slanderous lies of him engaging with the trans women sexually, he's like, yo, I'm trying to be respectful. I'm trying to grow. I'm trying to progress. I'm trying to be a better man. I'm not trying to go back to me saying the F slur, but y'all are tripping. But even outside of that situation, men spend way too much time fearful of what other men have to say because society status quo is this is what it means to be a straight alpha successful man. And this is why men have a confrontational and static relationship with each other. They want the validation, but they also don't trust each other. And when they do trust each other, they're too scared about what other men are going to say because they're always going to try to take some type of jab to their manhood, to their personhood. That's patriarchy. Whereas to the contrary with women, we enjoy compliments from other women. Trust and believe that. We don't spend the most of our lives, no homo, no homo. Oh, I don't want this bitch thinking, oh, I don't want people thinking I'm a gay. Oh, yeah. We don't do that. I mean, it's clear we don't do that. Like Katy Perry literally got a bop and got put on with saying that she kissed a girl. Like women literally go to a club and throw it back on each other and they friends. Quote-unquote diet gay. That's a new term. Like, we don't do that because A, we don't care. B, we know who we are. And C, a lot of men actually promote that lesbianness, you know, kissing on girls, sexual fluidity for women. It's Western men, not men all over the world, but Western men, American men in particular, they love that shit. So if women were to play into that, they're like, yeah, threesome. But we don't. For the most part, women don't. And for the women that do play into that, they're doing it for the male gaze. Most times, they are quote-unquote diet gay. Like, they don't eat pussy. They're not for young MA. But they do that to chase gaze. And in different cultures, even in America, if you play that diet gay, them men will put hands on you like other men because, you know, homophobia is still a thing. And no woman's like, oh, shit, she must a young ass baby. She gonna grab me by the pussy. She gonna convert me to LGBTQ. She gonna have me out here getting fucked with a plastic dick. Like, no woman ever thinks that. And trust and believe me, I've had some of the best compliments and, like, ego boosts from women. And no woman's ever like, oh, shit, she's trying to get me to be gay. Like, that shit, should I munch on my coochie? Like, these are not thoughts that we have. Even if they are actually lesbian, like, we, as women, are very comfortable for the most part in our womanhood, in our presentation, and our esteem that getting compliments, even if it is physical, about our body appearances, we don't take that as like an affront to our womanhood. If anything, we like, ooh, yeah, titties are sitting high, you saw that? Like, we think that's a compliment. We don't think that somehow is jading our womanhood. If anything, like, you notice that, like, ooh, thank you.
That's what we're living in patriarchy, in this death cult. And when men feel threatened, and when men feel like they don't have the upper hand, things get chaotic, things aren't going in their favor, they tend to punch down, literally, like wife beaters, literally punch down. And since we're talking about hierarchies and whatnot, punching down literally means punching on women, harming women and children, the most vulnerable. And in most societies, the way that a society is judged is the treatment and the overall quality of life for the women and children of that society. Y'all know what I say when it comes to the sexual assault stats in the United States. Title IX isn't just there just to take up space. It actually has to exist because sexual violence is predominant in the United States landscape. No different than femicide and other trauma and violent trauma towards women. In this death cult called patriarchy, ironically. This is the same reason why when men go to prison in this death cult, the first thing they worried about is dropping the soap. Now, men love to remind women that we be catty. Sometimes we be catty, but sometimes we be like Doja Cat, we just being in our Venusian energy, period.
He teaches me how to sing.
But there has never in life ever have women been sentenced to whatever years in prison. It was like, oh my God, I gotta worry about zipping up my asshole and zipping up my vagina. Like, these are not things that we think of. And that's not to say that sexual assault does not happen to women in prison, because it does. There are male guards and there are other sexual predators. It's not just men who are predators, sexual predators. But for the overwhelming majority, women don't think about things like that. But men do. Why? Why? Because of patriarchy. And the common denominator of patriarchy, someone has to be the bitch, someone has to be the hoe, someone has to be the pimp, someone has to be the alpha. In prison, that toxic energy is the norm. You're more likely to experience sexual trauma in prison as a man than you are in the free world. And that's crazy. Even with they're very anti-homosexual stance. They don't even provide inmates with condoms or proper health care, nothing. But it's very regular for men to assault other men, even if it's not sexual, just assault, like shank them up. It's very normal for men to antagonize other men, bark at other men, try to dominate other men, especially young men. Young men who don't know the leg of the land, young men who may have been on a small misdemeanor charge, it was nothing serious, but they wanted to throw the book at him, make him an example. That's who these men go after, these predatory men go after. Y'all remember that episode where that nigga in prison was like, oh, he a booty gangster, he just be robbing niggas in the shower.
But when Lockup visited Kentucky State Penitentiary, we met Fleece Johnson, a longtime inmate who practices a very different kind of homosexuality.
Well, we have sexual desires, right? So you got a bunch of men locked up in one place. All of them get hard. All of them's horny. All of them got sexual desires. So what are they going to do? You won't let them have a woman. They gonna have each of somebody's gonna have to give us some booty. And it's just as simple. In this prison, booty. Booty was more important than food. Booty, a man's butt. It was more important, I'm serious. It was more booty, having some booty. Was more important than drinking water, man.
Johnson went on to tell our crew how he used to satisfy his sexual desires, especially during the 1970s and 80s, when he was most active and prison security was more lax.
When I see one and he looks good to me, when I go see him, I say, you come here. I say, I'm telling you what, I like you and I want you. And we can do it the easy way out of the hallway. So the choice is yours, right? And it was always yes.
Johnson also had a warning for the new generation of inmates. They might be asking for trouble from old-timers.
You know, they got this thing where they sag their pants past their butt. It's a style. They call it some sort of gangster style. You know, it's sexy to us, right? And see, but they weren't prepared for this, right? So you said your pants in her, man, somebody be up in your butt, you know? And it's just that simple.
Johnson even let the lockup crew know that when he was in his prime, they wouldn't be safe from his advances either.
If y'all had been in her back then in them days, and as much as I like booty, I probably felt one of y'all butts. And y'all was walking past me. And dares you to say so. I'm not no shame in my game. This is nothing that I'm ashamed to admit. I am what I am. I'm a warrior too, you know, so let that be known. I'm a warrior.
And then we also saw that little white boy. He had to put the he had to put that Kool-Aid mix thing on his lips to show that he was quote unquote owned by another man.
Hold this for me. Here, hold this. This Kool-Aid. We put this on bitches like you. Lick your lips. Now stick your hand in that Kool-Aid. Just stick it in there. Now take your finger. Just do this to the bottom one. Come here. I kiss you, you orange flavor mother.
I'm Kessler. Your son's doing just fine. He sends his love.
Why's bad? I want to see that.
Don't worry. I'm taking good care of him. Things were a little rough at first, but he's doing much better since the transfer.
What transfer?
To my cell. You'll only get him into trouble if you do that.
I find out that you've hurt him.
Relax. He's much safer now than he was before. As long as he takes care of me and you decide to help, he'll be fine. You're a plastic surgeon, right?
Yes.
Great. Now, I may sound a bit old-fashioned, but I think it's the woman's job to maintain her appearance. Matt's a good-looking kid. Nice features. But the one thing he needs, what you can give him, is a nice set of tits. Huh. If you're worried the board won't approve the surgery, I've already got Matt speaking to the shrink in here, claiming he wants to be a woman. Papers got filed. There's a precedent for this.
You know, I don't believe that Matt would agree to any of this.
Oh, you wouldn't believe what he's agreed to since he's been in here.
Now look, I'm doing life. I haven't even touched a woman in 16 years. Do you know what that does to a man? How you learn to adapt?
Hey.
I can't go back to being the man I was any more than Matt can.
If I can help you, and in some other kind of way, I can give you money for an appeal, or organize a hooker or something. Or...
You got 48 hours. Your son's a good kid, but he ain't gonna be worth much to either one of us unless you do what I say. Trust me on that.
These are things that happen in patriarchy, not in matriarchy, in patriarchy, because the distorted view of this death cult says that there has to be in every scenario a bitch and a hoe. You can see this even in the workplace. Yes, there's all these rules and policies and regulations and laws and this, that, and the third, but still is wage theft. still is sexual coercion. Still, there is seniority. Still, there is office politics. And there's always someone or a group of people who are at the bottom and treated as such. And there are those who are at the top. And oftentimes, those who are at the top are skating off of nepotism. They're in the right social group. They're in the right family group. They're in the right situation. And that's what they're coasting off of. Not their hard work and merit. Basically, my uncle owned this motherfucking company and he gave me a 6-figure salary. So like, that's just that on that. I went to the right Ivy League schools. I went to the right motherfucking fraternities and now I'm here. Like, that's just what that is. Patriarchy, the death cult. Whereas when you call a woman a bitch, especially as a man, you're saying that in a derogatory term, no different than when a man says it to another man. When a woman says it to a woman, it's usually in that friendly, that's my bitch, whoop-dee-woo. But it's, again, it's a woman saying that to another woman. And in the system of patriarchy, it's like hierarchy of things. It'd be like two third-tier people recognizing each other. So there isn't that defamatory aspect to it because it's a woman recognizing another woman. No different than when Black people call each other N-word. In this system of racism, they're both N-words. So there's this, I see you, I am of you, and I recognize your humanity and the tier that we both occupy in this hierarchy of sex, gender, and all the other socioeconomic hierarchies, right? But as a straight person, if I were to go into a gay space and I start saying F-word this, F-word that, this stomp my ass out. They're not the gays of 50 years ago. Like, they'll put hands, period. But that's to say that it's because even though I don't think I'm better than gay people, not to say that gay people are less than, but because I am not of the same tier in this socioeconomic, gender, sex, race, sexual orientation hierarchy, heterosexuals being seen as the default norm, heterosexuality seen as normal, as average, as the standard. If I were to go around saying the F word, even though I have gay friends, I live in a very gay friendly city, gayness is not anything new. I would be seen as an outsider, demeaning and using defamatory words against the LGBTQ because I am not part of it. Why? Because the hierarchy of things. We're going to continue hammering that fact in because I need y'all to see the classism, the racism, the sexism, the patriarchy. I need y'all to see it in everyday ways and how that interacts with your relationship to one another, your relationship to this thing called society, and your relationship with yourself. Because there's a reason why all these little girlies love being linked up with these trash ass demon time niggas and they just cannot see it because they refuse to see the sexism of it all. They refuse to see the patriarchy of it all. So there'll be another cautionary tale because in their minds, they are the exception. But ask Megan her footage, she was the exception, if you catch my drift. But to get back to the original topic, this is a death cult. This is necromancy. Everything that we do involves some aspect of death, whether it's a death of dignity, whether it's a death of humanness, like Black Lives Matter, police brutality, like another person shot during a traffic stop, like a death culture, a death cult. Even with your religions, we'll go back to the Abrahamic religions, whether we're talking about Passover, that whole thing is about like...
Even with Passover, right? Passover started with the Hebrew Israelites trying to prove their loyalty, like a cult, like a gang to God, and basically put their first child on the chopping block, which was Isaac for Sarah and Abraham. So when they took that oath, angels would put lamb's blood on their door to know that they were down with the motherfucking oath. Like, but of course y'all don't want to see it, but like, what is this other than a death cult? Yeah.
The floods, right? 40 days, 40 nights. If you was in the ark, your ass was dead. A death cult. No different than Cain and Abel. One of them took the other one out. A death cult. Like,
When you start seeing how much death permeates within our culture and within our foundation and within the mythos that we believe in, you start to realize that, like, yeah, there's something really odd about that. And of course, that's going to reflect in our everyday society. We live in the United States. Violence is fucking ridiculous. And I'm actually going to add that video, Spirit put it on my chest, because I'm really having to download as I speak. I'm going to put that video that I saw. And I told you, after the Brooklyn shooter situation, I was like, you're going to see a lot more of these situations. Like, don't think this is a fluke. And you're going to see it on a multicultural aspect. What do I mean by that? It's not the stereotypical white, deranged, middle-aged white man with a gun. It's going to be men of different socioeconomic backgrounds, but more so men who are on the lumpkin proletariat side of things. And we'll get into that definition in a different video, but it's usually going to be those guys who can't keep up with society, who are gig workers, who are living on people's couches, who have some type of drug addiction. Like, life is not working for them. And it could even be men who had a college education or had things working in their favor, and it was just one slip up. Maybe they said this wrong thing to the wrong person, they got blackballed. Maybe they had some type of physical injury and then they got laid off and now they can't get back into their field, or whatever the case may be. Maybe it's offshoring, their company closed down and they went to another country so they could exploit the poor in another country, right? Whatever the case may be, you're going to see a lot more of these disgruntled men really shooting up the block, because in their minds they are in so much despair. And I've been said, a man in his ego is a dangerous thing. A lot of these men are going to feel a lot more despair. And when they feel despair, especially in this thing of patriarchy, you got to be hard, you got to be tough, you got to be strong. You know, you got to be the alpha man. You have to make other people submit to you, the brutality, and they're hopped up on drugs and Call of Duty. They're going to want to enact that. And I'm not saying this in the sense of, like, I'm cool with it or I'm promoting it, because, like, fuck no. But, like, this is real shit. You're going to see a lot more of these. I think what is different when it comes to the Brooklyn shooter versus any other shooter is the fact that he drastically did not fit the profile. Just like the DC sniper. When that shit was going on, no one was thinking, oh, we're looking for a black man, because it was preposterous, because in history past, those things weren't connected to black people, in particular black men. When you saw shootouts, it's usually like a drug situation gone bad, or a robbery situation gone bad, or a Chirac situation, or like a drive-by situation, which I don't even think niggas even do drive-bys anymore. But the point is, it's usually detectable about, like, what the scenario is. Like, it's in the middle of the hood, like, you get it. But, like, sniping from long range on the top of a roof, that doesn't connect with the typical profile of a black man. No different than the Brooklyn shooter. He shot up at a train station. He was an older black man, heavy set, urban aesthetics, tapped out his goddamn mind. But nonetheless, he doesn't fit the profile of, let's say, a Rittenhouse, or let's say even the guy who shot up the salon parlor in Georgia. The Brooklyn shooter did not fit the aesthetics, but nonetheless, he did the crime. And you're going to start seeing more and more of that, because not only do we live in a death cult of a society.
It's Monday, it's sadly becoming a trend to report on violent weekends in America. And from birthday parties to malls, this weekend was no exception. According to the Gun Violence Archive, there have been 143 mass shootings in the United States this year alone. Now, keep in mind, the year isn't even 4 months old yet. Now, CNN and the Archive define mass shootings as one that injures or kills four or more people. And here are the cities in 2022 alone. Philadelphia, four times. Sacramento, three times. Pittsburgh. Furman, South Carolina. Syracuse, New York. Vegas, three times. Baltimore, four times. Columbia, twice. Stockton, California, twice.
Brooklyn, twice. The Bronx. Baton Rouge, twice. Elgin, Illinois. Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Willowbrook, California. Indianapolis. Washington, twice. Miami, four times. Hartford, Covington, Kentucky. Buffalo, San Francisco. Dallas, twice. Shelby, North Carolina. Monroe, Louisiana, two times. Colorado Springs, three times.
Shreveport, Walterboro, South Carolina. Hollister, California, Cleveland, Waterbury, Connecticut, Chicago, 4 times, Milwaukee, 2 times, Houston, 3 times, Austin, Norfolk, Fayetteville, Dumas, Arkansas, Madison Heights, Virginia, Fort Worth, New Iberia, Louisiana, Lansing, Michigan.
Fort Lauderdale 2 times, Irvington, New Jersey 2 times, Ozark, Alabama, Reading, Pennsylvania, Rochester, Otagaville, Alabama, Columbus, Aurora, Jacksonville, Knoxville 2 times, Minneapolis, Hazleton, Pennsylvania, Louisville, Lubbock, Monroe, Chester, Glendale, Arizona, Atlanta 2 times, Alexandria, Louisiana, North Charleston, South Carolina, Bogalusa, Louisiana, San Antonio 3 times, St. Paul, Omaha, Des Moines, Portland, Oregon 2 times, Macomb, Mississippi, Charleston, Missouri, Turlock, California,
Temple Hills, Maryland, Joliet, Illinois, Racine, Wisconsin, West Hollywood, Murfreesboro, Tennessee, Little Rock, Springfield, Missouri, Phoenix, Romeoville, Illinois, Fresno 2 times, Wilmington, Las Cruces, Corsicana, Texas 2 times,
Blacksburg, Virginia, Oroville, Raleigh, Winter Haven, Augusta, St. Louis, Bakersfield, Inglewood, New Orleans, Savannah, Brunswick, Eugene, Oregon, Los Angeles, Montgomery, Jackson, Columbia, Missouri, Peoria, Dillon, Kenosha, South Bend, and Denver.
All told, since January 1st of this year, 151 people have been killed in those shootings and more than 600 hurt.
Now, this morning, a manhunt is underway for multiple gunmen after a deadly shooting at a party in Pittsburgh cut short the lives of 2 teenagers. Mass shootings also broke out in South Carolina and Boston over the holiday weekend, leaving several people injured. CNN's Shimon Procupes is joining us now. It is an epidemic. And I think just looking at that, we see the proportions of it.
And then yet again, as you said, Monday morning, here we are reporting on another incidents, several incidents of shootings across this country. This morning, we're reporting on 3 separate incidents, nearly 40 people injured as a result of gunfire. One of those incidents involved dozens of minors at a house party who summoned them jumping out of windows to flee the gunfire. In Pittsburgh, a mass shooting at a large party held at a short-term rental property. 2 17-year-olds were killed, and police say at least 8 others were wounded by the gunfire early Sunday morning.
It's heartbreaking. I mean, here we are, Easter, and we have multiple families, 2 that won't see a loved one.
Police say as many as 200 people were at the party, most of them underage.
How can you even have a holiday when your child was involved in something traumatic like this?
According to the police chief, multiple shooters firing more than 90 rounds inside and outside of the house. Some partygoers jumped out of windows, leaving some with broken bones and cuts, police say. The search for the suspects is underway, and officials are urging anyone with information to come forward as investigators process as many as 8 separate crime scenes. In Columbia, South Carolina, one man was arrested after a mass shooting at a mall on Saturday.
We didn't know who was shooting, what direction it was coming from, and it was really terrifying.
22-year-old Joanne Price appeared in court Sunday. According to the Columbia Police Department, Price is charged with unlawful carrying of a pistol. Police said more charges are possible. CNN has not been able to determine if Price has a lawyer. He's been released on house arrest. Police said they believe those involved in the shooting knew one another. The shooting left 14 people injured, at least 9 suffered gunshot wounds, and 5 others hurt while attempting to leave the scene. About 100 miles south of Columbia in Hampton County, South Carolina, police say 9 people were shot early Sunday morning at a lounge. CNN affiliate WTOC-TV reported the lounge was hosting an Easter bash when the shots rang out. Some people jumped into nearby ditches to avoid being hit, WTOC reported. The South Carolina Law Enforcement Division is leading the investigation. In Boston, police said two people were shot in the city's Chinatown neighborhood.
Both of these males were transported to local area hospitals, and both are currently listed in critical condition with life-threatening injuries.
Three suspects are in custody after the vehicle police said they were fleeing in crashed. Two were injured in the crash, but police said they do not believe those injuries are life-threatening. Boston police say what led up to the shooting is still unclear, but the investigation is ongoing.
And Brianna, certainly law enforcement all across the country is scrambling to try and stop this explosion of gun violence that we're seeing all across the country. One common theme that we're seeing in a lot of these shootings when we come back from the weekend is a lot of innocent bystanders, people out partying, people out shopping, just having birthday parties, are getting caught in the middle of crossfire between rival gangs or crews, people fighting and choosing to pull out guns to settle their disputes. And that's what law enforcement is seeing all across the country.
It's awful. Shimon, thank you so much for doing that report.
Easter
so
weekend
important.
Also.
Yeah.
It's just horrific.
Because necromancy is a thing. I mean, whether we're talking about thriller movies, and I'm going to be honest, I love my thriller movies. I prefer the psychological thriller. Like, give me a Gone Girl and I'm all setty. But most people, they like The Scream, they like The Purge, they like The Chucky, they want to see guts. That's a way to ingratiate you into this death cult. Same thing with religion. Before you take your first steps in this thing called life, you're already indoctrinated with some type of ritual, whether it's to cut the skin off of your ding-a-ling as a Jewish boy or those who believe in genital mutilation. It's not the same or to the extreme as female genitalia mutilation, but nonetheless, like, you don't need to cut the foreskin, but you do anyways, and it does cause some type of like traumatic effect. And for men, it does decrease their sensation of sexual stimuli, but nonetheless, that's what they do because that's what religion tells you to do, right? You're already baptizing your kid can't even say the word Jesus, but you already got to bathe them in the blood of Jesus, like all of that. Death culty. So the fact that we pass the bread and the wine, which resembles or is a symbol of the body and the blood, a death cult, like all of this death culty. Now, if you take away the religious symbology and the good-hearted scriptures and whatnot, what would be the difference between what you think Satanists do and what you actually do as a Christian? I'll let you ponder on that. But nonetheless, we live in a death cult society. We live in that. Even the way that we engage with one another in the space of hip hop, the way that we even discuss sexual relations. I beat the pussy up. I murk that thing. I make that pussy hurt. I make that pussy pain. It's just like, God damn, nigga, is this a prison rape? Like, what is this? Because we live in a death culture. And because we live in hierarchy of sex, so like male, female, and the hierarchy of race, Black woman being the lower end on the thing called gender hierarchy or sex hierarchy, which would be like men on top, patriarchy, that's what we live in, and matriarchy on the bottom, that's where we do not live in. And because it is men on top, that's always the dynamic in the back of their head on some subconscious shit. In the back of their mind, they're always finding a way to overthrow the woman, to overburden the woman, to lessen the woman. Whether we're talking about manspreading, whether we're talking about mansplaining, whether we're really talking about shooting a woman in the foot, in their mind, there always has to be a pimp hole situation, and they got to be the pimp. They got to be on top. They got to be the alpha male. They got to be the one to exert their manhood and their toughness and their brutality, because in their mind, that's what manhood is. In their mind, that's what patriarchy is. And in their mind, that is the prototype of what a man should be. And they continuously reenact this. And when they step out of the architect of what it means to be a real man, what it means to be an alpha man, there's always other toxic men to check him and tell him, oh, he's acting out of line. You're becoming too soft. You're becoming a bitch. You know, you're acting like a sucker. You're acting like a punk because you're actually having human emotions, because you're actually treating people with respect. And that's toxic patriarchy. But it's not necessarily just toxic patriarchy, because we could always be like, okay, beating on women is wrong. But it's the other subtle ways that men find to objectify women or to make women more subservient or women to question themselves or try to
make women insecure. It's all these low-key, subtle psychological ways of quote-unquote putting women in their place. But patriarchy has always seen women as the birthers and the child rearers for the production of capitalism. That's what women have always been for. You're here to breed, raise these kids so you can send them off to the factories and send them off to war. And the system of things isn't so much different. Outside of the United States, most women's existence is to be bred and to raise them kids. Whether we're talking about areas which still do child marriages, which is wild crazy to me, or areas where they're pretty much modern, the thought is, as a woman, you are here to breed and to raise them kids. If you're a good woman, then you get wifed up. If you're a bad woman, then you're just used as a glory hole, a walking glory hole. You're here to sexually satisfy men. And let's be real, most sex workers are women. That's not by surprise. And even if you live in a modern country, you're married, you're a woman, you have rights, you have this, you have that, most women will align with their husband, with patriarchy, and be on some Serena from The Handmaid's Tale than they would be June. No matter how many girl bosses and other pro-woman hashtags come out here, when it comes time to stand on your square, these white women vote Trump. Like, that's just what that is. Like, that's just what that is. So when we're talking about these intricacies and we're talking about these intersectionalities with race, sex, sexual orientation, socioeconomics, and things of that nature, there's just so much depth there is. And it all pinpoints at patriarchy, pinpoints at colonization, imperialism, pinpoints at this hierarchy that the rich and the wealthy, they get to be anything. They get to be drug addicts, i.e. Joe Biden's son, Hunter Biden, a whole crackhead. They get to be sexual deviants, i.e. Jeffrey Epstein and his whole buddies, including Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos, Beyonce. I saw her name on the flight, motherfucking logs, all them motherfuckers. So they get to be the worst of the worst, but get the media spin of being the best of the best. Meanwhile, you and I and everybody else are just trying to get by, and we're still getting squeezed. No money for the child tax credits, no more, finito, but got billions upon billions to give to motherfucking Ukraine. And if you think a corrupt motherfucking country like Ukraine is actually spending that money on the motherfucking people, I got you a motherfucking dusty ass bridge that I could fucking sell you. Because if you know anything about geopolitics, especially when it comes to the Ukraine, they've been corrupt. They've been neo-Nazis, and they've been funded by the United States. So this ain't shit new, but let them tell it, the death cult must continue. Even when we're talking about geopolitics, the fact that we exploit the global South, knowing that it's going to kill them folks, knowing that it's going to hinder these folks' self-determination, knowing that it's going to plunge these people into more and more abject poverty and put them very vulnerable to being exploited by even more vicious demon time men. We don't stop. We don't stop. Because it's a death cult. That's why. I mean, the fact that we are living on the verge of climate catastrophe, but we still gonna hop up in that core. We still gonna drive, okay? Green energy, what? Greenwashing, like, shit ain't gonna change. Death cult. Death cult. The music that we listen to, shoot a nigga up, kill a nigga up, death cult. Death cult. The way that we even engage with one another. I go ghost on a bitch, mask on, mask off. None of it is prosperous. It's fleeting. It's momentary. It's microwavable. And it is dispensable. You can always throw it away. Hence, you know, the issue with climate change, because like we have a lot of shit like plastic, but we can't get rid of it. But here we are producing more of it. And, you know, it causes more problems environmentally, especially when we have tons and tons of plastic in the water. And it's so much plastic in the water that now they're finding babies born with plastic in their bodies, because we know eating plastic is dangerous. So I guess like it flowing through your bloodstream can't be that dangerous. Why? Because we live in a death cult.
The seafood industry in particular, So those who do like bycatch, they catch anything in the waters, including dolphins, including turtles, including animals that we don't eat. And by the time they pull everything that they catch in those big ass nets, those industrial nets into the boat, whatever they caught, even if they didn't need it, they didn't want it, they're not trying to eat eels, it doesn't matter. It's in the net. It dies with all the other seafood that we would eat and sell. So they get hit just because they were in the wrong proximity. They were just too close to the net. So we are pillaging everything in the ocean, including the animals that we don't eat, because we live in a death cult. And you don't want to know how farming, in particular, raising cattle, what that does to the environment, or even raising chickens, what that does to the environment, how much water is wasted, how much land is wasted, how much methane is caused because of these animals. Like, we don't really want to get into the nitty gritty of things, because bitch, we just want our beef, god damn it. We just want to eat our motherfucking chicken. We want to eat our scrimps. We don't want to think about how things get produced and end up on our tables, because we live in a death cult.
But I don't want to rant too long. Y'all let me know what you think. Do you see what I'm coming from? Did you get that channeling as well? Did you get that spiritual download, as I was saying it, from the chest, from the hip, from the dome? But seriously, we live in a death cult. From the way that we engage with one another, from the way that we interact with this thing called reality, to the things that we believe in, all of it has its origin in someone dying. Even when we're talking about rebirth in the sense of like resurrection, someone had to die. And it's not even like, oh, they died gracefully in their sleep. They died at the age of like 100. No, someone had to be tortured. Someone had to be gutted. Someone had to... It always has to be some tragic torment, because we live... because we live in a death cult. That's why. But y'all let me know what you think. Like, comment, share, subscribe. And I shall see you in the next video. Peace. I'm gonna leave it here, but y'all let me know what you think. Like, subscribe, comment down below, and share. I fleshed out a lot of different topics, so there is not a scarcity of things to talk about in the comments, but let me know what you think. As well as, I have a lot of links to the articles and things that I mentioned within this video down below, so definitely check it out. I do not come without any receipts, and I shall see you on the next video. Peace.